Good evening. Tonight we can reveal exclusive details on the ambush of four young police officers on the Western Downs, with the killers digging underground caves and sniper foxholes lying in wait for the officers to arrive. Intelligence agencies are now monitoring extremist chat rooms for any evidence of copycats.
3 days on at the remote property where horror and heroism collided, the hunt for forensic evidence finally begins. Delayed until the bomb squad could sweep the home for booby traps.
As we're grieving, everyone wants many answers very, very quickly, but we have to be extraordinarily thorough.
Grief will be long-lasting for the families of murdered constables Matthew Arnold and Rachel McCrow.
The chat with the families was some of the most difficult chats you can have. They wanted me to know Rachel and Matt not just as police officers, but what they were like as children growing up and who they were as people. Even some laughs as they remembered their loved ones and some of the quirky things they did in life.
Specialist investigators examining how long the train's new police were coming to the compound.
This lonely dirt road was the only way in of Nathaniel, Gareth and Stacey Train's sovereign state, as they called it. Remote, isolated and heavily fortified so they could protect it with deadly, murderous force.
Driveway barricades were designed to slow a vehicle's path, with surveillance cameras alerting the Train brothers a car was coming. Seven News can reveal two foxholes were concealed under a mound of scrub with living quarters dug into the ground, including a campfire. Gareth and Nathaniel Train lay prone in full camouflage with rifles trained on constables Matthew Arnold and Rachel McCrow. Matthew was shot as he stepped over a wire fence. Rachel was wounded in the leg, making her own tourniquet. Keely Bruff dived for cover in long grass, while Randall Kirk's car was peppered with bullets as it screamed out of the property to call for help. One brother, likely Gareth, seized Matthew's Glock, used it to kill Rachel, stole their police radios to monitor movements and set fire to their car into the scrub, trying to flush out Keely. Hearing the gunfire, then seeing smoke rise, Alan Dare and Vic Lewis from neighbouring properties drove to the front of the Train's property. Alan had called 000 by the time he got out of the car. That's when he was shot, collapsing as he handed his phone to Vic, who fled, collecting Alan's wife, Kerry, from her home and meeting police. Alan, never to know who was really living next door, neither did those close to them.
It was a shock to the system that how can somebody that's we've known as a teacher, as a friend of the family, what made a tick? What made that switch flip? What happened?
The twisted tale of the conspiracy theorists said to be locked in a love triangle unfurling. Stacey left her marriage to Nathaniel to take up with his older brother Gareth. The mysterious off-the-grid trio worked in the education system in regional Queensland and New South Wales, a state where Nathaniel held a gun licence. Queensland police insist appropriate risk assessments were done with the information at hand.
There were no issues, no concerns about the officers going to that address.
Intelligence agencies also making inquiries. ASIO is monitoring conspiracy websites where the actions of the three killers are being praised.
Their security agencies are actively considering the implications of this matter for the national security of our country.
So a tragedy like this might be prevented. Now, Seven News understands that the coroner did visit the crime scene today because he wanted to walk through it himself, to feel it, to experience exactly what that crime scene was like. He wanted to get a feel of the temperature, the conditions there. He also wanted to make sure that he gave instructions to those investigators who were on the ground to make sure they get everything that he needs to make a thorough finding at the end of all of this, Max.
Steve Hart in Chinchilla. Well, tonight we can take you inside the dramatic rescue operation as officers in two police helicopters, themselves under fire, directed the highly specialised and skilled team below. The recordings are a rare insight into the dangers that night, and we warn some viewers may find it confronting.
Both POIs now weapons facing right side, and as you can see there, they've got the spotlight. has a number of cartridges on the rear tray, and that is where he's reloading his weapon. Police TTO received, yeah, a number of shots going off there continually every 5 seconds. Blair T said, we're happy that we've seen a pair of legs in the red side balcony, so assume that to be the POI female.
That chilling audio from the police helicopter. Well, Tara residents plan to honour Rachel McCrow and Matthew Arnold, as well as neighbour Alan Dare, with permanent plaques and statues. Tributes outside the local police station are growing by the hour. Mourners travelling from far and wide to pay their respects.
Tara police station almost deserted, except for three officers out from Ipswich, honouring fallen colleagues in their own way. One mowing the lawn, one rearranging tributes, one planting some of those flowers in the station's garden. Tributes here are growing for Constables Rachel McCrow and Matthew Arnold, as well as neighbour Alan Dare.
It's a shock to everyone. Yeah, they didn't deserve that.
Rachel's former partner travelled from Brisbane to pay his respects. Too devastated to talk on camera, but telling 7 News, "It's just rocked me. I'm absolutely shattered. And I don't just speak for myself, but I speak for everyone, because Rachel was just a beautiful person. You can't take that away from her, and she just didn't deserve this at all. She'd do anything for you. She loved her dog. She'd do anything for him. I'm just really appreciative of the time we got to spend together." Grief and sympathy is being felt deeply in Tara.
I think it's important now that we support these guys and know that on our properties, they're always safe. And it's not who our community is about. We support our police.
Talk among locals is now turning to how best to honour Matthew, Rachel and Alan in the long term. With vigils and services about to get underway, some are suggesting naming local landmarks in their memory or building a statue as a permanent reminder of their bravery.
There is no definite plan at the moment. It is about receiving suggestions, and those two events, it shows the solidarity of our community, it shows the compassion of our community.
I've thought of a beautiful garden. A
couple of statues of police officers around the lagoon with a blue light on them to light up with the night. That would be wonderful. But we're looking at a lot of money, but if we will raise it, the community will raise it to get there.
A lasting reminder of their courage. Tomorrow evening, the Western Downs community will come together for candlelit vigils and to raise money for the 3 lives we've lost this week. In Chinchilla, it will be held at the Allura Retirement Village here in Tara, just over the road at the local footy ground, tying in with a pre-planned community Christmas get-together. Max, both events will begin at 5:30 p.m.
Thanks to Harry Clark reporting there from Tara. Well, tears have been shed in the nation's parliament as the 2 fallen officers were honoured. The loss of the young constables has been felt across the country, including by those preparing to follow their calling.
Marching proudly to join the ranks, 41 new police graduates welcomed onto the thin blue line, a protective force that suffered a heavy blow.
Today is in some ways a bittersweet day. We also still extraordinarily saddened and will be for many years to come.
Those still in training, still feeling the loss. A heavy reminder of the duty these recruits promised to uphold. The sacrifice honoured on the country's landmarks and at the meeting place of the nation. First by the Prime Minister.
All we can offer is the humble thanks of a grateful nation.
And then by a former Queensland officer.
The callous lack of heeding the pleas that would have would have echoed in between the gunshots.
As a mark of respect in the memory of Constable Matthew Arnold, Constable Rachel McCrow and Alan Dare, I ask all members present to rise in their places.
In less grand surrounds, but with no less feeling, grateful people pay their respects. Firefighters in Chinchilla with a guard of honour and a travelling pastor offers his prayers.
Just the loss of life. The waste. It's so sad. The families. Right at Christmas time and all.
Final details are still being worked through, but it's understood a joint memorial featuring full police honours will be held for Constables McCrow and Arnold next Wednesday here at the Brisbane Entertainment Centre before families hold private funeral services later that day.
The families who are going through what is the most torturous time in their lives.
With the support of the police family, state and nation behind them. Joel Dry, 7 News.
The QPS says the right risk assessments were done at the time with the information they had. The information they did not have is Nathaniel Train's history with guns. Ian Levers is the head of the Queensland Police Union. Ian, why didn't police know more about who they were dealing with?
Well, what I do know, it was a routine call for service for a missing person inquiry. But what has been identified is within Australia we have many jurisdictions where our computer systems are chunky and cumbersome and they just don't talk to each other. It's been since 1996, the Port Arthur massacre, we had reform in relation to licensing of firearms in Australia. It is now time for a single database right across Australia so the police have all the information available to them, and that it means whether they have a firearms licence, what firearms are registered, and any issues or reasons of a concern that we know in relation to their history. And I think now the technology is there, it is time for action and it needs to be done now. And what I envisage is a police officer in Mergan will have the same information at their fingertips as the police officer in Penrith. At this point in time, our systems just don't talk to each other.
Is the national cooperation there to make this happen, do you think?
Look, I'm going to pursue this. This is something I'm passionate about. I'm not only pursuing it on the firearms, but also in relation to domestic violence. I think the will is there, and that with it coming out of a tragedy, if something good can occur, that is what I'm going to do. But that is a passion, and that is something I'm going to lobby with both sides of politics.
Now, Ian, just briefly, you visited the scene of this tragedy. What did you learn from being on the ground? What did you see?
What I saw, it was eerie and sickening, knowing what our police went through, as well as Alan. But the positive part I saw was the hard work of the police who are out there, who are gathering all the evidence they possibly can to be able to formulate a brief of evidence for the coroner, which maybe will answer some questions, because there are a lot of questions and no answers. But on a positive note, we need to do this to honour Rachel and Matthew as well as Alan. That is really important. But we had police from many disciplines, our forensic police, those from the bomb squad, the dive squad, as well as the Ethical Standards Command, who are doing a very important role in trying to reconstruct everything they can. So hopefully we can find out what occurred, not only for the families to honour them, but also the community are wanting questions and answers to be done.
Crucial work that they're doing. Our thanks to Ian Levers. So thanks for joining us. Queenslanders who want to support the families of the two murdered constables can help by donating to the Police Union's Remembrance Fund. Details can be found on our Facebook page. There's also a fundraiser for the family of neighbour Alan Dare. It's already raised more than $60,000.